just you?
Yeah, just me. He'll probably like put his head through there.
So welcome back after lunch. I hope everyone had enough to eat. Yes, good. This afternoon's session, the first of this afternoon's sessions is on masculinity, and it's about kind of moving into some of the talk of primary prevention, some of the talk of social norms. I wanted to start by explaining why we're talking about masculinity and explaining why we're talking about social norms, because I think those of us who work in the sector are really used to going out and raising awareness of sexual violence in our communities, eh? We're really used to going out and talking about how awful it is and how often it happens and who it happens to and where our services are so that people know where to go if something's happened. And that's all incredibly important work and we all need to keep doing it, but it's actually not primary prevention. Primary prevention is that stuff that's about changing the whole social climate that our communities live in. I think the analogy for me, and I'm a vegetarian so this is probably obvious, if I think about growing beautiful vegetables in my garden, and I think about the plants I don't want to have in that garden, the weeds, and I think about how I might get rid of them, I need to know what they look like, and I need to be able to pull them out, right? That doesn't mean I'm going to grow beautiful vegetables, especially not in Wellington. What needs to happen for me to grow beautiful vegetables is about the soil that the vegetables are growing in. That's what primary prevention is about. It's about the soil that our communities are growing in. Creating soil that nurtures respectful relationships, that nurtures good relationships between people and good relationships between peoples. Okay, so that's why our headspace for this afternoon is beginning around masculinity. We could have chosen any kind of social phenomena to focus on. We could have talked about race and colonisation. We have a consent document in New Zealand called Te Tiriti o Waitangi, which wasn't respectfully upheld. We have a really good example of why social norms around that need to be looked at if we want to live in respectful communities. We could have talked about social norms around disability and about the way we think about the bodies of people with impairments and how problematic that is in terms of sexual violence. We could have talked about social norms around sexuality and the fact that our community believes that some kinds of relationship are more important than others. Some kinds of love are better than others. All of those things are important if we're thinking about respectful relationships. But we've chosen to talk about masculinities for a couple of reasons, really, and I'm going to talk about that in a minute. We also have a panel of magnificent speakers who are going to talk to you about their take on this. I'm just going to ask them to give you their names now before I talk a little bit more and hand over to them.
I'm Fati. Just call me Fats for short. Nice to meet you, everyone. And I acknowledge all the men that are here today, all 10 of us. Thank you.
I'm Tommy.
I'm Mike.
Okay. So it's a bit funny to have a masculinities panel and then let myself speak for quite a while. I'm aware of that. But I'm going to go with it.
You're a PR.
Yeah. Okay, so the main reason we need to talk about masculinity when we think about sexual violence is because of how most sexual violence between adults happens, right? These are police stats. We know they're not perfect because we know not all survivors report. But of adult victims of sexual violence in New Zealand, 95% of them are female. Just 5% are male. It's even more astonishingly gendered when we look at who perpetrates sexual violence. There we've got 99% perpetrating a male. That doesn't mean that all men perpetrate sexual violence, though, but it does mean that we need to think about some of our social norms around masculinity if we want to be living in a world that doesn't have sexual violence in it. And I reckon one of the best ways to do that is to think about, okay, I've got a little boy in my life, I want to buy him a present. I'm going to go down to the warehouse, our biggest retailer, where I can buy him an array of violent things, or I can buy him things that allow him to be a police officer or in the army or in the fire service. If we were going to look at a page for little girls, it would look completely different. We'd have the opportunity to cook and bake and clean and look after dolls. Yeah, and that's in 2012. So we live in a really gendered world right from a really young age. What this plays out like when we get to starting to think about being sexual is really interesting though, maybe the most interesting thing. When we learn to start being sexual, the messages we're getting from dominant youth culture, this is 1979, Greece is the word, right? For those of you that are too young to remember, it was the word. It's also still being replayed in Wellington cinemas now on Friday nights as something for young people to go to. It was a love story, for those of you not familiar with the storyline, between these two characters. I want to play you a song from the movie so we can have a bit of a think about the youth conscious soil that our young people are learning about masculinity in, right? And I want to invite this half of the room to listen to the things that the young men in the song are saying, and this half of the room to listen to the things that the young women in the song are saying. Okay? All good? Yeah, singing along is not compulsory.
But encouraged.
Young women think was happening?
Money.
Did they talk about sex?
No.
Talk about love, eh? Okay, what about...
they did lots of skipping.
Very important for effective sexual violence prevention. What about the young men? What about the Thunderbirds? What were they talking about? Yeah. What were some of the phrases that were coming up? Did people call them? Yeah, did she put up a fight? Yeah.
Was it the saving her life that he was?
Yeah. And she was, he was showing off, or he was saving her life. Depends who you believed.
Did she have a friend?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So I'm going to go out on a limb here, and even though that piece of rape culture was really, you know, funky, made me want to dance, I'm going to call it a gender script for sexual violence, because I think what was happening there, what the two stories, the two genders were talking about there, wasn't just making sexual violence possible, even just likely, but it's making it almost inevitable, eh?
Mm-hmm.
When we have an expectation that women will put up a fight, even when she's good, you know what I mean? And when we have young women not even able to talk about sex at all, we have an incredibly problematic dynamic, eh? In terms of growing soil that sexual violence isn't flourishing in. Now, of course, that was 30-odd years ago, so no doubt things have changed. Let's jump to the next biggest piece of youth culture that's happened recently. So Twilight and all of its sequels, best-selling books for every year they've been released. Twilight and all of its sequels, each one the best-selling DVD for the year it was released. All of the movies are in the best 50 selling movies of all time. So incredibly pervasive messages. And yeah, we're talking about white American culture, but this is everywhere, yeah? For those of you who've been living in a cave somewhere, this is about a young woman called Bella. Twilight's about a young woman called Bella. She falls in love with a beautiful vampire called Edward. She also meets and wrestles with an attraction for a beautiful Native American werewolf called Jacob. That's the story. There are so many messages we could be talking about here. I'm only going to focus on a couple. So Bella, right from the beginning, when Bella sees Edward, she wants him, okay? This is her talking very early on. She says, I moved even more slowly than he had, careful not to make one unexpected move. I caressed his cheek, delicately stroked his eyelid, the purple shadow in the hollow under his eye. Traced the shape of his perfect nose, and so carefully his flawless lips. His lips parted under my hand, I could feel his cool breath on my fingertips. I wanted to lean in and inhale the scent of him. That's pretty damn sexy, I think. That's a woman talking about someone she really wants to touch. And then, so I dropped my hand and leaned away, not wanting to push him too far. So we have movement from Sandy in Greece, eh? We have a young woman able to talk about wanting, but she still has to contain what she does with that wanting, because if she doesn't, his behaviour may well be out of control. It sounds like a pretty old message to me, that one. So that's the first message of masculinity I wanted to focus on from Twilight. The second one, when Edward and Bella get together, it's the culmination of the love story. We're all excited, it's fantastic. This is the first conversation. You weren't excited? This is the first conversation that Edward has with one of Bella's friends after they get together. So he answers the phone. Hey Tyler, this is Edward. His voice is very friendly on the surface. Bella knows it well enough. And remember, they're just getting together. She knows it well enough to catch the soft edge of menace. Always sexy. Hey. I'm sorry if there's been some kind of miscommunication. Bella's unavailable tonight. His tone changes. The threat in his voice is evident now. To be perfectly honest, she'll be unavailable every night, as far as anyone besides myself is concerned. No offence. Now, in the book, this isn't controlling, or a sign of dating violence, or a red flag for get the hell out of here. This is sexy, because he wants her so much, he wants to spend all of his time with her. Okay? So that's the second set of gender messages in Twilight I think we need to be thinking about if we're thinking about the youth culture that our young people are learning to be young men and young women in. And we might think this stuff doesn't have that big an impact, but when you look at what young people in New Zealand say about how they want to be sexual, you can kind of see some of the impacts it has. This is a piece of research that was done in Victoria University in just 2010. They went into a whole bunch of high schools and asked a whole bunch of young people who'd had sexual violence prevention education, so us, and they'd had sexuality education, sexual health education. They asked what the messages of that education had been. And they asked the boys in particular, you know, what do you think about outer course, which is a term that family planning use for kissing, touching, licking, stroking, everything that's not intercourse, basically. Fun stuff. This is what the boy said. Callum said it's orals. Aaron said it's sort of like foreplay. The interview's like, oh, yep, oral. Everything but sex. So the interview's like, what's that mean? The group say, inserting. Sex is inserting. the interviewer says, right, does that count as sex? Nah, that's not sex. Why doesn't it count as sex? It's not the act of doing sexes. So for these young men, unless they're inserting or doing, they're not having sex. Unless they're in that role of being the person who's making what's going to happen happen, they're not really having sex. If we think about what that might mean in real life consent situations, that's really dangerous, eh? It's another way we need to change the soil around how we think about sexuality and how we teach those messages to young people. So these young men here from Twilight, and when I show this picture to Kim, she asked me what the ripples were on their stomachs. What's that, Sandra? I have to say, I didn't date boys who looked like that when I was 17. Anyway, these young men here, these are hyper-masculine young men, right? They're beautiful. They're things that young women are being taught to look at and like, and young men who are attracted to men are being taught to look at and like. And the messages from the book, we've already talked about, hyper-masculine, not able to control themselves, going to be controlling in relationships because that's what real love looks like. This is the stuff that we really need to think about changing. These are the social norms that are really damaging and harmful for young men and for young women. When we were putting this panel together, the main reason was there is a whole bunch of evidence, but there's also, I think for most people, a gut feeling that if we're going to be working on masculinities with our young people, we can't do it without men. This is a picture from 2010. It was a sexual violence prevention hui that RPE hosted in Auckland. 40-odd people, 8 men, helpfully illustrated with very, very fetching photoshopped arrows. I'm pleased to see there's 10 here today, Fati. You counted, did you?
Yeah,
awesome. I would like to see double that next prevention hui. We need men here. We need men to be part of the conversation. Part of the reason I wanted to hear men talking at this hui was so that we could have that conversation about how does it happen? How do we connect our two worlds? I'm incredibly proud to be part of a feminist movement that's been seeking to end sexual violence for an awfully long time now. I'm incredibly proud to call myself a feminist, and I know that we can't do it by ourselves. So what does that look like, really? It looks like moving beyond seeing gender as a black and white situation and moving into looking at masculinity being expressed in a whole range of ways, that whole rainbow that we see up there. Because actually, the way we do it at the moment, it's harmful to relationships between men and women because there's power being expressed in those masculine norms, eh? Without doubt. It's also harmful to men who don't fit those norms. It's harmful to people that don't fit those gender norms. And more young people are telling us that they identify as genderqueer now. More and more young people, we're realising that more and more young people are intersex. More and more people are intersex. There's a whole bunch of reasons why this doesn't work. Those really rigid masculine roles are really damaging around young men who aren't attracted to women as well. Aye. That's my introduction to hearing from these three female speakers. I'm going to invite you guys now to help us talk through how we're going to do this. Sure.
That's not microphone, eh?
Oh, it is.
Oh, so they can hear me or not really?
So it can be heard in the camera.
Oh, okay.
In the film.
Sweet. Do I stand up or?
You can do whatever you like, Mike.
Oh. You guys want me to stand up or I'm okay? Stand up? Oh. Okay, I'll start now. Okay, what it means to be a man. I am known as Chung Lai Sang in Hong Kong, but in New Zealand, known as Michael Robson. The reason for this is because I grew up in an orphanage till the age of 5 and was interracially adopted by a European couple. In my life, there have been 3 major cultural influences in what a man is. Number 1, the white European man. Growing up in a white dominated area with a white European family, I learned that being a man was through violence and fear. I was often teased at school for being different, like being a ching chong, and for not having real parents. The only way I could adjust and to adapt was to be smart, study hard, learn English, try to fit in, which didn't really work, as I always felt like an outcast and out of a place with no real friends, but a couple of Pacific Islanders. At home, being a man meant to study hard, lose my identity, my cultures, my language, become white on the inside, and mentally as well. Both my adoptive parents were physically, emotionally, and psychologically abusive towards me and also towards each other. A man's role was to go work, make money, and rule the household through domestic violence for small things such as not having dinner ready, or to the standard that was expected, to wasting money on dumb things around the house. My only real escape from both worlds of school and home was to take ages walking home, reading and doing homework in my room, often locking myself in there all night as soon as I got home, or running away to the local park and bush. I tried hanging myself at the age of 11, and I ran away from home and lived on the streets for a week at the age of 10. They eventually got divorced. I stood up once against my adoptive mother when I finally had enough of her abuse and threw her against the wall, saying I was getting sick of being beaten up by her. The fear in her eyes triggered memories lost so long ago about the love and care I received at the orphanage from the woman that looked after me and my fellow brothers and sisters. Number two, the Pacific Island man, Tongan to be precise. At age 15, I started bulking up and started to learn that my fists and strength was the only way to gain respect from others. Also started the process that having a girlfriend or liking a girl was part of the social status and how it defined you as a man. I started hanging around with the Tongans, Maoris, and Samoans, or in general, the people who didn't really fit into the westernised schooling system of New Zealand and the culture of study. Up to this point, I was a straight A student in all my top classes of Lenford College in Auckland City. That's where I'm from. I learned being a man was about playing rugby, fighting, having fun in life, such as stealing, breaking into the cars, making money, smoking weed, drinking alcohol, and in general being a nuisance to the school and to the general public. P.S. I don't smoke, I don't drink, and I don't take drugs, and I never have, and I never will. But the main thing I learned at this stage of life from the Tonga family that I grew up with, that family was important, and to be a man was to provide for your family and for the friends that hung around you. I never saw any of the domestic abuse that is always associated with island families I grew up with. Number three, Chinese Asian triads. I went to prison for various assault charges on two white males and I put them in hospital. I got sentenced for 1.5 years. Upon release, I went through a deep state of depression where I started harming myself, slitting my wrists, and overdosing on antidepressants. My way of getting through this was by joining the triads. You guys know what triads are? A police officer should know. Sorry. Okay. All right, carry on. Okay. Through them, I found a sense of identity, culture, and belonging. Being a man in this world was to have money, power, respect, and boys. I turned that around because I had no money, but I had my fists. And through that, I gained respect, boys, power, and their money. The bosses were always known as playboys and having a main girlfriend and side girlfriends. If abuse happens to the girl, it is not spoken outside of the family because of the shame associated with the abuse. Here and now. So for the last 3 years, I have grown my passion of helping others and have done volunteer youth work for different organisations. I also went back to study to get my level 4 certificate in social work and youth specialisation. But despite all this, I am held back by my past confessions. This is the third time I am speaking in public about my past and trying to make a difference using my past experiences. So what does it mean to be a man in today's society, and how do we change the mindset of what masculinity is? Anybody? Okay, I'll try and give you guys my answer. Okay, so everybody has their own life story of what a man is. As you can see from my life story, I've had three different versions of what being a man is. As people get older, it changes according to their life plans and past experiences and influences. For me nowadays, to be a man is to share my life experiences with a younger generation who are going through the issues that I went through, and to be that father figure, big brother or male role model they never had. Despite everything life has taught me and what being a man is, I am still afraid of not living up to society's standards of what being a man is. I have no job, career, financial stability, a car, a reason to live. Throughout my life, I have always tried to be a better man in whatever field of life I have chosen. Being a man, in terms of a relationship, is being able to provide for your family and the basic necessities of life, from love, clothing, schooling, food, and a roof over your family's head. But for many in society, and for many men, they have to sacrifice one or the another in order to survive. Nowadays, nobody really seems to know what a real man is in a relationship. I am trying to spread the word that being a man is to speak out for what is right and what you believe in. It is okay to give a voice to those without a voice, to stand up for those that can't stand, and that to be a man, sometimes you have to get in touch with your feelings and emotions and let other men and women see them too. Okay, that's it.
Thank
cool.
you,
Mike. You would love your mix and anything else, Lars.
Hi, everyone. Did you press the wrong button? It's hard to follow that. So, I'm Tommy, and I guess today, talking about masculinity, such a weird thing to talk about. Obviously, I'll give you a little background. My masculinity is an adapted form of masculinity. I'm a trans man, so I was born female, and today I live in the world generally as a short white Pākehā dude who's a little chubby, which is a very distinct different world to the world that I grew up in as assumed butch, female-born person, or woman. And so, I guess the idea of masculinity for me is a very fluid world. I made a choice in my life to become masculine, i.e. Have external gender physical bodily things occur to so that I could go out into the world as a man and people go, oh, that's a dude. So those things are taking hormones, having surgical procedures, and adapting myself to transitioning into and behaving as a man in the world. There was a whole process that evolved from, and it didn't evolve when I was 18. It evolved when I was born. So I believe that I don't really believe I am a man, if you can get my sense. I am a person, I'm Tommy, and I have masculinity. But my masculinity hasn't developed from just my genitalia. So my masculinity has developed similarly as most other men from the world out there around me, as well as possibly some sort of movies, Greece. Quite a lot of my masculinity has come from Greece. You can't see it now, but when I was younger, you could really see it. my masculinity has come from an adapted world. I, as a young person, I didn't talk to anyone. I just watched. I didn't talk until I was four. I believe that's because, you know, I was too busy trying to figure out what the fuck was going on in my head. And I wanted to know exactly how to be in the world. I don't have a background of any familial violence or any experiences of any sort of sexual abuse until I was in my teens. Mm-hmm. So, and that's when I went out into the world. So within my family, I was allowed to just be me. I didn't have any notion of genitalia. Like, my brain isn't built to go, oh, that dude's a dude because he's got a penis, and that's a woman because she has a vagina and vulva. Did I say that right? Yeah, I learned that this morning. But I had no concept of that until I was five, and I learned about masculinity at school because I went to school and I couldn't go to the toilet. Because all of a sudden I had to go to the toilet with the girls. In my head I was a boy. So that masculinity was growing like any other young boy. I didn't have Barbie dolls, but there was no sort of enforcement there. It was just the way I was. And the enforcement occurred when I went out into the real world. Suddenly I had to go to the toilet. So then that was quite a difficult period of life. I couldn't go to the toilet quite often. Didn't want to go to school. It was quite distracting. Hanging on to go to the bathroom all day. And then I decided, okay, I have to pretend to be a boy. None of this is verbalised. This is all in my own head. I would wake up, I'd go to bed. If I wake up in the morning, I'll look like the other boys. Like my father, my brother, I didn't get that they had different genitals to me. I just went, oh yeah, that's cool. You know, I'm still me. But when I got to school, the kids told me that I was a girl and that I was wrong. So I went to bed every night and said, I want to be a boy in the morning. And that was a dream for many, many years. So as a child, by the time I was five, I managed to get my hair cut off. I just refused to brush it, so it was becoming this big net in the back of my head. I would get upset about wearing short socks. Something as simple as short socks compared to long socks. Boys wore long socks. Why was I wearing short socks? I cried all the way to school one day. Just because I was in short socks, it's quite traumatic. Otherwise, that was obviously me being gay as well, sort of expressing myself. And then I had, so all of these interpretations. So I got to around about my teens, and I found out what trans people were. I'd been living in a haze. I don't even remember most of my childhood from the age of five. Any of my primary school years are gone, don't know. Don't remember the people I was around. I remember one teacher from my school in Rotorua where I went to Ofora Primary. I liked him because he let me run in boys' shorts. So I remember him. So lots of that stuff is quite sort of wishy-washy. Then, so by the time I hit puberty, unfortunately, the worst day of my life was when I became a woman, as my mother called it, and I started my period. And life ended, really. And that's when depression set in. I was like, oh my God, obviously I was an early bloomer, like most trans men. Actually, we start to have, you know, we tend to have some hormonal issues going on usually in our system. And so we do go through puberty earlier. Many of the stories I hear from my peers. So I was encompass some femininity. I tried to encompass, I loved Boy George. John Travolta was born the same day as me. Maybe I was like him. I tried to encompass sort of feminine masculinity and hyper-masculinity. None of that really worked. And unfortunately, most of my masculinity then was interpreted via films that we're talking about here. So as a very young woman, I became sexual very early on. I explored my masculinity through risk behaviour, and I explored sexuality, which threw your masculinity out the window quite quickly. Suddenly I had people calling me a lesbian, so not only was I not sure about my gender, I didn't have any idea about sexuality. So if you can imagine, I was asexual. Technically, today you would call it asexual. We didn't have those words back then. We only had gay, lesbian, bi. There wasn't even a T or an I around. So we had just gay and lesbian and bi. So I tried to be bisexual. I tried to be a lesbian. And I called myself the 100% lesbian, the 5-star lesbian, but it was a lie. So I lived all these very distinct lies because I actually had lovers that were men. Because I'm, you know, I soon was trying to be, I couldn't be female, but I discovered that I could be a masculine woman within the lesbian community. I was a terrible lesbian. I did not do well. I never picked up. I have zero ability to have feelings conversations. And I just couldn't get the candle shit right. You know? Just couldn't. So I took further steps and then I started discovering masculinity. So the way I discovered masculinity was I didn't emulate my father, or my brother. I didn't emulate anybody. I invented my own. I figured out soon enough that if I needed to discover something, I had to try it. And I'm a visual learner or, you know, one of those kinetic sort of people. So I lived as a man from about the age of 21. And I invented a club called King Victoria, and drag kings were manifesting. So I performed gender, and that's how I discovered masculinity. Unfortunately, I didn't do some things I did okay, and some things I did really bad in. So obviously, due to the fact that I had all these issues around my masculinity and my gender, I was pretty much a misogynist pig. So I over-accentuated my masculinity to the point that I was pretty offensive. Nowadays, we all go through this phase where we, you know, it's like I was suddenly the 12-year-old boy telling everybody what to do and women for the kitchen. And I went through, you know, not liking feminism, hating the lesbian community, being angry about women. And finally, that's how I discovered my masculinity. So it's kind of interesting in the sense that it was the women who showed me the way to find my personal history around my personal story and my spirit that was masculine and safe and happy. And that was through relationships and basically having somebody recognize my masculinity, even though I wasn't presenting as a man. And so it's a very different concept of masculinity. It's a very fluid concept of masculinity. I took 10 years to transition. And when I say transition, it took me 10 years really to say, hey, I want to be a man. Early on in my transition, I was what I called a no-ho. It was a cool term within the queer scene at the time. And that meant I was not going to take hormones. I tried herbal hormones and all this kind of whack of shit. It was great. It's basically like bodybuilding and all that kind of stuff, thinking, oh, yeah, this will do the job. I'll just get big muscles and a six-pack like that dude, and then I will feel really masculine. And gradually I discovered that doesn't help. And didn't help me because I couldn't connect to myself because I couldn't get those muscles. I'm really lazy. And so there's aspects of that are really hard to deal with. But I also discovered that there's lots of ways to be a man, and it was really up to me to decide to make that choice. And one day I just basically went, well, what sort of guy do I want to be? And I'd observed men my whole life. I'd idolized them, put them on pedestals, and I just couldn't connect them to who I was. And as soon as I did that, smack bang, here I am, a gay man, standing here going, oh yeah, that's cool, I've got it now. You know, it was like really quick. It took me about 3 years, and that was including hormonal stuff, taking hormones, you know, growing fur, my voice changed. All those physical things obviously helped me connect with who I was. And that was the answer, a little bit of the answer. It wasn't the only part, but I had to really, really go there. But I really fought it. It's not a decision that you make like that to go, hey, well, as a woman today and tomorrow I'm going to be a man. I don't believe that the hormones and surgery are necessary for our masculinity as a F to M female to male, transgender guy. I don't go around telling everyone that I'm a transgender guy. I'm just a guy. And part of that journey has included domestic violence for me, where, you know, I've been in situations in regards to relationships where my identity has been used against me in an abusive manner, and my ability to connect to my sexuality and my actual sexual desire has been part of that. I've experienced negative aspects to that. And so now in the world today, as a trans man, I'm quite open about being trans, but I'm also very clear that, you know, I don't know how to do it all. I don't know how to be the perfect trans man. I don't believe there is a perfect man. And I believe that we all should encompass, you know, both the male and feminine energies in our lives to be a good person. So, but I do respect my masculinity and my femininity much more now than I ever did before. And I believe that there's a spectrum, there needs to be a broader view on masculinity and femininity to be able to encompass the notions of our bodies. So I find, as a trans guy, that the concepts of binary are obsolete. Like, I do not understand them. I'll nod my head and I'll go, nah. And I won't, I mean, I'm not going to fight the fight for every single conversation that's binary in society. But I think we can start by giving a little bit of a broader scope to masculinity. And I think we have, as our masculinity that we have in the community that is so diverse. I'm a person that's transitioned, but I was a person that didn't want to transition, and I was a genderqueer person, and I wasn't. You know, I went through all those terminologies and I felt those worlds, those in-between androgynous worlds, that people within that realm have a lot to offer and a lot to give back. But we need to find access points so that our masculinity can be, explored. So I guess, my key message is that masculinity is an exploration, and whether you're cisgendered, i.e. you're the gender that you were born as and you're happy with that, or whether you're transgendered, that we all can be a bit more fluid around our gender expression in regards to masculinity. And the only other thing I'd say is that, because I liked how you ended your talk, I'm copying you. I'd like to say that in my world today, the work I do isn't just about being trans. For me, it's about connecting with all people. So once I discovered who I was and how my masculinity fit me, I was able to engage with you. Before that, I was an isolated, lonely person who didn't make everyone laugh, who actually was really harmful to themselves and didn't say anything. So my part of my work is finding those people in my world and helping them walk along the path to get into this realm. I'd like to say that there's a lot more trans people out and about in your worlds, and it's really good way. It's a really good thing to discover how they've made it out into the wider population, because there's some clues there in our work as prevention model builders, and I'm not the expert in that at all, but I think there's some clues there that we can learn from them. So that's my sort of view on diversity and masculinity, really.
I'm a bit full, I ate too much. Can I just get everyone to stand up, just to give yourself a stretch first, before I bore you guys in my position?
I was just standing up, I'm going to sit down.
Get a good stretch. And when you're ready, grab your seat again.
It's always a good tactic.
No way, just break the ice. I just wrote my speech.
Okay, I had in my mind a whole bunch of things, like, and I was like, so I'll talk about this, talk about that, and Sandra asked me to talk about this and that, and I was like, shucks, I'm going to sound like verbal diarrhea if I don't sort out what I'm going to talk about, but I just wanted to hear what my boys are saying. I acknowledge Biffy's, you know, mean their stories, different backgrounds, I learned something again, I sort of changed how I want to deliver my story again, so, I guess the question, so, I'll talk about a little bit about myself. So I'm an educator with Wellington Sexual Abuse Network. I've been in the role contract there since 2009 with Sandra and a few others that are here. My other hat, I work for MSD. Went for a response. <time. laughs> Okay, so MSD. So I'm running the youth services contract out at Work and Income. Been in the role for 5 months. My life before that, I was at Vibe running programs for young men. Not just young men, but programs for young leaders as well. And my other hat, I'm an expired gym instructor, but I should be back in about 6 weeks, so got the phone call. But anyway, the question is, what is a man? Well, masculinities, but in my mind, what is a man? Is a really good question if you ask men today. But an even greater question is, when do you become a man? I'll ask that question to a guy that's 30 years old. They wouldn't even have a clue when they become a man. So these are the two main questions that I ask when I run my programs. I want to just cover the theme of our two speakers before. I got the story about this Christmas ham. I'm not sure if you guys have heard about it, but I always tell the story about Christmas ham where a mother and daughter are doing the Christmas ham in the holidays, right? And when she does ham, she cuts the ham in half, puts it on two trays, chucks it in the oven. And then the daughter goes, "Mum, why do you cut the ham in half?" And then the mum goes, "Oh, my mum did it." So So the daughter, luckily enough, there was like 3 or 4 generations in the same house. Just going to make up my story. Okay. Okay, so then the daughter goes up to grandma. "Grandma, how come we cut the ham in half, chuck it on two trays and chuck it in the oven?" And she goes, "Oh, my mother did it." Okay, so then she went and asked her great-grandma, "Why do we cut the ham in half, chuck it on two trays and chuck it in the oven?" And then the great-grandmother will say, "Oh, because in those days, the ovens were smaller." Mm-hmm. Now, in terms of the context, we don't know what we know. We only know what we know. That's what we're talking about. So in terms of being a man, we only know in terms of your story and in your story, we only know what we know from what's around us in terms of cultural context. So for me, growing up as a young Samoan, New Zealand born fella in New Zealand, my parents come from Samoa, so they come with their way of thinking and they come in here. So an example there of what I grew up with is we'll be watching like TV, like, you know, Shorten Street or something, and then there'll be a kissing scene. And my mum will go, "Oh, change the channel." And I'll be like, "Well, what was that for? You know, change the channel, man." Like, and then the littlest thing, we'll get in trouble or something, like just for watching like the rudest scene. And for us, when they reacted in that manner, it was like a real taboo thing. We're like, "Oh, shucks, we shouldn't be looking at that stuff." So at an early age, we learnt to not look at that stuff, and at an early age we learn not to even go there or even talk about it. So as we grew up, we only learned this sort of stuff at school. And we were learning at school, I remember being like real shy, like, sex, this, "Oh my gosh, she's a sex." She's a bush. She's a bush. And the only time we ever talk about it is amongst our peers. So our peers could be my first cousins or our boys. And you know, like, that's how we base our views on sex and being men. I think another thing too, just as me and Sandra facilitated a program for sex and ethics program for our Young Pacific, the last one we did like 2 years ago maybe, we sort of found out that another thing too, we knew that it was a taboo subject. So the session has six weeks, but we added a seventh. And the seventh we put, so we added an extra session before it started. And the reason why we did that one, because when we promoted to young people, we were saying, "Hey, come to this program about relationships." And when they turned up, we're like, "That's about sex." But once we got them in, we were like so nervous. We were so nervous that when they were there, we're like, "What's about sex?" And they were like, "Oh," I could see them like get real awkward. And because male and female dynamics in the same room of Young Pacific, they were like real awkward. And we were worried they won't come back the following week. The following week, two extra people came in. Like, "You dirty mother." But just the dynamics of how, yeah, so. But in terms of like growing up on what we know, just also another thing that I learned from their group too is Young Pacific, the only way they can talk about it for some of them is when they're wasted through drinking, or being, you know, being stoned. And for them, it's an excuse to behave in that manner, which isn't cool, because you know, like, when you're in that state, you're not really in 100% thinking, but that's how it happens for young people. Like, the only way they can get dirty on the dance floor, and they wake up going, oh, sorry, I was wasted, I can't remember. Whatever. But that's just an example. So I guess just talking about me growing up there. So for me, when I talk about my sort of journey, it's, I grew up in a buzz where my father passed away when I was 11. So it was just me and mum, and my younger brother was about 2. He got adopted out to my auntie and uncle. So it was just me and mum growing up for the years. So for me, I was like, what does it mean to be a man? So my auntie and uncle, they adopted my younger brother, took me and my mum, and we lived like next door. So it was like a village concept that Bruce was talking about downstairs. So we lived that sort of concept, and we lived like a big ass unit, and I was surrounded by my uncle, surrounded by my first cousins. And we sort of grew up knowing what it means to be a man. But my mum was like the one that always saying, you never hit girls. Like, they always stuck with me. Like, you know, you never do this, that. So it, as well as changing the remote, the channel, like all that sort of stuff, that sort of played a big part. So even to this day, I admit, my partner's not here, okay. I admit, I still would not initiate sex. It's just the thing that it's my mind. Like, it's one of those things where what my upbringing has caused me to think, like, I'll wait till she's ready. And as for me, if I initiate, I feel like a rapist. I don't know why, but it's probably because of the changing remote scene, just those sort of things. And like for others, it could be a different story, but my story comes to this side. And it's one of the stories to tell because obviously I do represent a stereotype too. So like for people, like people see this, oh, spooks are Samoan fella. Oh yeah, this guy's gonna be rough. But really I'm like, no, oh, chicken. I want to talk a little bit about my background, but I also want to talk about my journey. Eh? So my journey and how I've come to the role. So a lot of it plays a big part into why I'm in the field I am today. My biggest sort of style is I work with young men. I've been doing it for a few years now. I've run like six programs when I was at Vibe a few years ago, and I started to learn how to work with young men, and I started to figure out this logical sequence in terms of working with young men. So not just young men, but in terms of anybody I work with. So at the end of the day, we all know that we're human. We all have the same sort of things, at least we hope so. But when I start thinking about how I'm gonna deliver my programs or how I'm gonna work with young people, I think about gender, okay? So gender. So an example is like I figured that how males work, they work differently to females. But I almost got challenged from your story. I was like, okay, maybe it'd be different when I heard your story. But I'm just gonna say this from my experience, okay? So an example, my partner will come home and I'll get him from work. And I'll go, oh babe, what's for dinner? And sorry, that sounds so cliche, but but I'll just say an example, say, okay, babe, what's for dinner? Okay. And she'll go, oh well, I went to the supermarket and then I went and checked out the fish and it was like $9.99. I was like, whoa, expensive. So I looked at the chicken and I saw a chicken and I saw my mate saying that she had a baby the other weekend and the baby was crying and she couldn't sleep and really having a real bad night. And then she talked about how they're gonna go out this weekend, the baby's gonna go to a babysitter, and then yeah, we're gonna catch up for coffee. And we go. I'm like, so dinners. What's for dinner? Whereas I asked one of the boys, like, bro, what do we have teeth? They're like, oh, fish and chips. Just how I've understood the experience of how working with like the gender specific stuff. And the way I've sort of seen it, because when I was growing up in school, like we had a suicide. Okay, so everybody was grieving, everybody was going through their mourning process. Now when I saw girls mourn, they were talking, crying, like talking through the things, but all the boys will sit in a big ass group and just sit there quietly. Like, just real different dynamics, eh? And that's how I've sort of figured out, like, that, like, somehow males and females just process things differently. Like, an example, me and my missus will have arguments sometimes. And then we'll argue harder and I just shut down. And she's like, you're not talking to me! I'm like, I'm just going through my process. And then probably a week later, I'll be like, oh, babe, you know you're talking about the other day. And she'll be like, what are you talking about? I'm like, okay. So this whole gender thing, like in terms of working, you know, with the work I've done, I've noted how to, like, understand that genders, we process things differently, we process information differently. They would need to learn a different sort of manner. So in terms of the work we do in terms of young men, like we'll figure it out in terms of the program we run with Sandra. And, like, we need to there's a time and place for together, but there's a time and place to do the work separately, because there's a time for the boys to sit there quietly and they'll give you an answer. There's a time and place for the girls to go, because you know, when the question's asked, there's the line down here and the girls will find the answers this way, whereas the boys will like make their answer, find the answer. They still come to an answer, but there's a different way of getting to the end point. So, and then, but when the two dynamics are together, it's like seeing as you're not talking to me, or you shutting down, or you know, so that sort of stuff. So that's the stuff I want to talk about in terms of like, because I understand that there's, my story is masculinity, but it's also a story about how I want to put my experience in how we work with young men. The logical sequence, is being human, gender, okay, male, female. The next one, I'll say age. I won't say culture, I'll say age first. The reason why I say that is because I think it's important to understand the development stages of where they're at. Hey, so in terms of young people like to be in a interactive sort of feel, whereas, you know, like, it'll be different for age. And then I incorporate culture. In terms of the cultural context, we needed to add in the extra session for our cultural context, because it needed to be comfortable, we needed to have a process where we brought everything out of the carpet, all these years of not talking about it, and they were saying, hey, you can talk about it, give them a week to think about it and come back, I'm ready, and they brought their friends, you know, that sort of stuff. That's just, I'm just talking more so my people, because that's me as a Samoan, but I know the Tongan culture. I've got brother-in-laws that will not go into a room when there's girls in there. Like, they'll sit there and they'll stay outside. There's an example when the girls are sleeping in the room and all the boys are sleeping in the car outside. Just an example. Like, it's just, again, to their Christmas ham story. They don't know why they do it, but it's just because something that they've learned, and there's an uncomfortable feeling. Another thing, too, I went to a church conference a few years ago where this man as presenter was talking about spirituality, and he showed clips of his wife giving birth to his babies. All the Tongans and the Samoans just walked outside. And I was like, it was just one of those things, you know, the dude probably wasn't informed, but it's just one of those dynamics. Yeah, it's just so easy to see that it's so taboo for the subjects. And me being a Pacific Islander in this work of delivering sex and ethics, man, uncomfortable, but learning, but I love it. Because I love being pioneering to things, and me going into churches, I am a sex and ethics educator. So that's... But I'll chuck in some examples of what I do with young people. So, I was asked by Sandra about this thing called Superman syndrome. Anyone heard of Superman syndrome? Okay. So when people ask this question, what is a man? And people say, oh, man's about. Oh, so, like, usually the boys will even say sex, drugs, alcohol, and then we do this program where we say, nah, you know, well, it's more than that. So they talk about bring home the bacon, provide a protector. But we're like saying, okay, but now it's not like that anymore because. Our female counterparts are doing the same thing. So what does it mean? So we're putting those questions forward. So I use this term with Superman syndrome when they start to like realize what they used to be, but then it's about being creative of how they can be. So I tell these boys when I take them away, I'm like, no more you having the status of, yeah, I'm the man at drinking, yeah, I'm the man at getting with the girls. It's about you putting a different costume and saying, I am this superhero, that superhero. So example I do, I won't start with Superman, but I'll start with Green Lantern. Green Lantern? The dude with the green, with the ring, okay? Okay, we know that the young boys will say, oh, yep, men is protector. We're like, cool. Green Lantern's a protector. We'll talk about the responsibility of having the ring, and we'll talk about how he wears his costume to protect. There's a time and place to protect. Okay, so only certain young people will connect with it. And other young people go, oh, what else is a man? Oh, young person is a provider. Cool. We talk about Batman. Batman, the philanthropist. Because he's got all this money. He doesn't abuse the money by doing random stuff. He's like giving back to the community by doing flashes, gadgets, that sort of stuff. Yeah? And then we do, what else is a man? A young person, like, I don't know, the things about guys, there's this fix-it sort of stigma. Like, you know how you've seen men that start, doing DIY around the house and they don't finish?
Yes.
Yeah. So that sort of stuff. Like for me, I'll break. Oh, back in the days, the Walkman. Walkman. Remember the Walkman? So I'll break a Walkman apart, and I'll figure out how it works, and then put it back together. Okay, so this is a fix-it sort of stigma. Okay, so we go. Oh, so what does that mean? So we talk about how problem. Well, like, we've got this problem solving stigma. So we go. Okay, cool. We call that person the Hulk, because the guy is like problem solving. He's a scientist, but he can't handle his emotions. So he gets angry. And we're like, you know, that's where the masculinities, you know, they can't control their anger sort of stuff. Yeah, and then we talk about how the two different costumes, like you either got this costume and how do you learn to control that. But the difference about the Superman syndrome is the total package. And the reason why this is our total package is because if you think about it, Superman is not the costume. Clark Kent's the costume. So there is no Superman, because we all think we're invincible, but really, Clark Kent, like Superman's like the there's no one like Superman, so we have to be real. So that's sort of stuff we talk about in terms of Superman syndrome. And the reason why the Superman syndrome is more common for people that do, like, probably us boys now, like, probably they're going to get to a point where we're going to be overworking, like, where we're like, see as the hero for every day, and, you know, we're saving people. But sometimes we're going to get to a point where the red undies are going to be a bit too tight, and the cape's going to get a bit too tight around the neck, because, you know, we've been overworking. So that's another thing. So we talk about the self-care side of being a man. So that's another thing we talk about. I guess the last thing I want to leave with is, what does it mean to be a man? Oh, I sort of said that. For me, when we talk about what does it mean to be a man, I think every man, or every woman maybe, but for me, when I preach when I talk to young men, I said, you need to find your measuring stick of what a man is. Okay, so you can't just look at, you know, you can't just look at what you see on TV. You got to find what you think. What's your measuring stick? How do you measure yourself to a man? So when I started this boys group program, we got together and we got all these senior, older looking fellas with these young boys, and we had this group together. And I know that I'm not going to be everyone's measuring stick, but it's about putting other places for other ones. And then, so what happens is, when boys look up to really cool men, they go, oh, I want to be like that fella. Yeah, I want to be like that fella. And like, I'll have the same for me. Like for me, see, for me, because I'm Christian, my measuring stick is Jesus, okay? So I measure myself to that. But it's not, that doesn't mean it's everyone's, but I'm just saying that that's mine. So I'll ask the question to the boys, what's yours? And they find theirs. And then they sort of, because they start getting challenged about what they think in terms of the Christian, what they think a man is. But when you start putting in some good measuring sticks, then they start going, man, I can't wait to be like that man over there. So that's just my message for today. And sorry if I was having like verbal diarrhea. I might have more, but... yeah. So that's pretty much me. So thank you.